For now, we'll start on the material. So we are looking today and then also tomorrow and maybe into the next week at quadratic functions. If I could have everybody's attention, please. But tomorrow is just going to be another lecture, by the way, with only 2 days in the week. It doesn't make sense to have a review day. So a quadratic function is a function with the following form. Q of x equals ax squared plus bx plus c. And here a and b and c are constants. And we have only one requirement on these constants, which is that a is not allowed to be zero. And that's because if a were zero, that whole thing would go away and we'd just be left with a linear expression, bx plus c. So it's that non-zero a that makes an expression quadratic instead of linear. So that's as a purely sort of algebraic definition. This is what quadratic functions are. We should discuss a few of their properties. To begin with, we should probably take a look at what these quadratic functions look like. And essentially, there are two options here. Every quadratic function has a graph, what we call a parabola. So it can look something like this, or it can look something like that. If we call up Desmos, we can very quickly look at some examples. Say f of x equals 2x squared minus x plus 1. There's a quadratic, there's its graph. Or g of x equals 3x squared minus 0.17x. This is also a quadratic. You might object that it's not in the form that I put on the whiteboard, but you can think of having a plus zero sitting there. So this is a quadratic, ax squared plus bx plus c. And here, again, sort of trying to head off potential objections, you can think of this subtraction as adding a negative term. So you can have addition or subtraction. It's still a quadratic either way. H of x equals negative x squared minus 1. So here's a quadratic in a different form, or I should say a quadratic with a different graph. It's still a parabola, but it's arranged differently. Now it's opening down instead of opening up. So what's the difference? That is to say, if a quadratic can sometimes look like this, or a quadratic can sometimes look like this, what's the dividing or the deciding factor here? The answer to that question is that it's that A that's deciding the shape of the graph. And in particular, whether A is positive or A is negative. If we go back to Desmos, zoom out so that we can see everything. You see here A is positive 2, and here A is positive 3, and these quadratics are both opening upwards. Here A is -1, A is negative, and this quadratic is opening downward. So we can see an illustration of this. And now that we've kind of introduced the idea of quadratics, we maybe have several questions that are worth addressing. But does anybody in the audience have questions about what I've said already before we continue?
So if the A is a negative, then the parabola will be facing down.
Right.
It's not.
If A is negative, it's down. If A is positive, it's up. So, some sample questions that we might be asking ourselves. This is not a pure math class, so I never expect anyone to find these topics sort of de facto interesting. So maybe the first question are, what good are these? I mean, where do they show up in real life situations? The second question we might ask, is now that we've introduced these functions, what are we going to do with them? Like when we were working with linear functions, we had this kind of array of things we learned how to do. We learned how to find slopes. We learned how to find the equations of lines, things like that. What can we do with quadratics? Well, in many ways, it might make the most sense to answer that first question first, but a lot of algebra students I've found tend to find word problems and story problems kind of intimidating. So I don't want to dive in with applications. Let's look at some applications, word problems, story problems tomorrow. But I will try to answer the concept just sort of in a vague, sort of large point of view. The sort of obvious, but maybe not obvious, answer is that quadratics show up a lot in real-world situations. So I'm not going to give any equations on this frame, but just some sort of classic examples of quadratics. The height of a thrown object. I've actually always found this example slightly banal, but it's such a concrete example that it's hard not to at least mention it. If you toss an object in the air and you look at its height as time passes, that height will be quadratic. A car's fuel efficiency is quadratic. In particular, a car's fuel efficiency depends on the velocity that the car is moving at. If it's moving too slow or if it's moving too fast, its fuel efficiency will be poor. So we get something like this. If it's moving too slow, the fuel efficiency is poor. If it's moving too fast, the fuel efficiency is poor. And somewhere in between, there's a sweet spot where the fuel efficiency is at its maximum. You see quadratics in sports statistics. I don't know if this is of interest to anyone in this room, but like if you look at a pitcher, a baseball pitcher, and you look at the years into their career, and you look at various numerical statistics, you often see curves that look sort of like that. In the early parts of their career, they're still improving, so their various statistics are increasing, then they peak with age, and then as their career progresses, their statistics start to go down. So basically anything where something goes up, then goes down, or goes down, then goes up, is an example of a quadratic, or at least it can be. So, as I say, I don't want to put any equations on the board just yet. As I say, we'll do that tomorrow. But I hope that we can agree, maybe, that these do have applications and that we can imagine applications. And then we sort of ask, okay, well, what can we do with quadratics? And we're going to learn to do two things with quadratics. We're going to learn to solve quadratic equations. And we're going to learn to find maxima or minima. We already know how to do this on our calculator. In fact, on the test you're going to get back, there was a fuel efficiency question. But quadratics are simple enough that we can find max and min values without messing around on a calculator. There's a simple formula that we can learn. So these are our basic goals. And today, I'd like for us to learn how to do this. Solve equations involving these quadratics, involving these ax squared plus bx plus c's. And this might or might not be familiar from high school. But let's state a very specific goal. We'd like to solve equations specifically of the form ax squared plus bx plus c equals zero. And it's a very natural question to ask, why zero? I mean, what if we want this quadratic to be equal to something else? What if we want this quadratic to equal 2 or to equal 4? We'll get to that. In fact, we'll get to that today. For now, let's state this as our goal, as the next thing we're going to learn how to do. And we are going to learn something called the quadratic formula. Either famous or infamous, depending on your point of view, quadratic formula gives us a way of solving equations that look like this. And this is the only way that we're going to learn in this class. If you ever learn how to factor, for example, or learn how to complete the square, well, that's fine as far as like your personal education goes, but we're not going to learn that, and we're not going to use that in the classroom. All we are going to learn is the plug and play formula. X equals negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4 times a times c all divided by 2 times a. So good news, bad news, and let's get the bad news out of the way first. It's probably pretty obvious without me saying it, but the bad news is that this is quite an ugly formula. The good news is, since I'm letting you take note cards into the test, you don't necessarily have to commit this to memory. You just need to be able to use it. If you have got it. So it's not a lovely formula, but there's no need to memorize it. And let's go right into an example so we can see how this formula is used. Again, tomorrow, I'd say tomorrow we'll look at word problems and very concrete applications. For now, there are no applications behind this. We'll just solve a quadratic using the quadratic formula. And the quadratic formula, I said you don't have to memorize this, but years of teaching this class have burned it permanently into my mind. The quadratic formula is that. So we're just going to identify. Here's A. Here's B. Here's C. And we're going to take these and we're going to plug them in. So where C appears, there's going to be a one. Where B appears, there's going to be a five. And where A appears, there's going to be a two. So equals. B is five, so negative five plus or minus the square root of negative five squared minus four times A times C all divided by two times A. So what we called plug and chug, and here plug and play in Nebraska. Maybe it's a regional thing, but we're just taking numbers and plugging them into the formula. And it is then just a matter of trying to simplify this thing. Negative five squared is positive 25 minus eight all divided by four running out of room here, but let me see, 25 minus 8 is 17, all divided by 4. Question.
Under the bracket where B is, why do you have it negative? B
Where?
square, five, negative five square.
Oh, right. Completely right. That was a error. It did positive five squared, also 25, so this is still correct, but thank you for pointing that out.
You know how 2x to the squared, what do you do with that second power? The two that squared over the other two from the original problem.
I don't totally
Oh, it doesn't carry over.
Oh, it doesn't carry
Yeah.
over? Okay.
Okay. This is a very normal way to write your answer. So I don't care about, like, can we multiply, can we write 17 as the product of squares and then simplify, whatever, I don't care about that. Notice that this is two answers. And it's two answers because of this plus or minus sign. So, sort of running out of room here, but let's carve out a niche. Maybe if we erase that line, we'll have space to work with. So this is negative 5 plus the square root of 17, all divided by 4. And it's negative 5 minus the square root of 17, all divided by 4. So it's written as a single expression, but it's two answers. Let's look at some variations of this. Does anybody have any questions before we continue? So this will still just, let's see, squared minus 4x plus 1 equals 0. This will still be very plug and play. The only observation I want to make is that if you have a negative number, like you have that minus 4x, that negative number is going to go into the quadratic formula. So, the quadratic formula, this negative 4 is going to go into there, and it's going to go into there, and negative 4 is going to give us positive 4. Now, a negative number squared is positive. So we're going to get positive 16 minus 4. And here A is positive 2. And C is positive 1. So all divided by 2 times 2 equals, as I say, negative negative 4 is positive. Negative 4 squared is positive 16. In the denominator, 2 times 2 is 4. And There's your answer, and you could pretty it up a little, but the reality is, I mean, if this were a word problem, we'd probably just want a decimal. And we'll get decimals when we do word problems tomorrow. So in terms of taking something like this and making it as pretty as possible, what's the point if you're just going to stick it into your calculator anyway? I would always sort of thought that to be a wasted effort. Questions so far? Then let's go back to a question I asked earlier. I said we were going to learn to solve quadratic equations. And then I said, okay, if you have a zero over there, this is what you do. But what's so special about zero? Maybe we want to set a quadratic equal to some other number. And the answer is that we can still use the quadratic formula as long as we're a little clever. So we need to do a step before we start plugging stuff into the quadratic formula. But if we have, let's get some negative signs just for variety, negative x squared plus 3x plus 4 equals 1. Again, we'll look at word problems tomorrow. For now, sort of just plucking stuff out of the air. How could we solve this? Well, the answer to that question is if instead of having a 1 here, we had a 0, we could use the quadratic formula. So is there a way to get rid of a 1 algebraically? Well, there sure is, and it's a pretty straightforward way. If we subtract that number from both sides of the equality, suddenly we have a quadratic that's set equal to 0. And once we have a quadratic set equal to 0, it's plug and play with the quadratic formula. So I'm sort of stating this in terms of this example, but this is a general method. If you have anything other than 0 here on the right, you add or you subtract it away. And then negative b, so here's b. So x equals negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4. Here we need to be careful. We can think of having a negative sign as having a negative 1 in front of the number. So b squared minus 4a is negative 1. Here's our c. All divided by 2 times negative 1. And let me see, we're running out of room, so let me see if I can do this in my head, or not in my head, let's have scratch work up here. 9 minus 4 times negative 3 is 9 plus 12 is 21. So negative 3 plus or minus the square root of 21, all divided by negative 2. We'll pick right back up with this tomorrow. I mean, I've promised you story problems, but for now, we'll just practice the quadratic formula so that when we have word problems, we can do the math that's underlying them. And now, get you your test back. I left comments for a few people on the grade book, but for the most part they were fine.
Appreciate it.